In this canto, Aurobindo has been sharing with us the secret knowledge which King Aswapati has received as a result of his spiritual development. The goddesses of wisdom and inspiration and intuition and revelation and discrimination, discernment, have revealed many great secrets of spiritual knowledge to him. And this spiritual knowledge Sri Aurobindo has shared with us in this canto 4, the secret knowledge. This is the knowledge which is underlying all the rest of the book. This canto has 7 sections, and each of them reveals to us a different facet, a different aspect of the secret knowledge. It's as if he's highlighting one aspect and then another and then another. And as we come towards the end of the canto, he has revealed to us that it is the divine himself, the Lord himself, incarnated in each of us, in all the creatures of his creation, individually in each of them. And in each of them, he is seeking for himself as one forgetting. He has put away his own knowledge. As one forgetting, he is seeking for it. And the image that is given for this searching is the Vedic image of a sea journey, traveling by ship. And in this section, this last section, Sri Aurobindo shows us the soul, first as an apprentice, learning to sail his vessel, this vessel of an earthly embodiment, the ship of the body, learning to use that. And with wonderful imagery, he shows the development of the human consciousness from the tamasic stage to the rajasic stage to the sattvic stage, and then even further. And he's been telling us that this sea journey is being driven by the mother's force, that she is guiding the sailor on the way. So that was how we closed last week. I'll just read the last sentence. It starts on line 934. Across the salt waste of the endless years, her ocean winds impel his errant boat, the cosmic waters plashing as he goes, a rumor around him, and danger, and a call. Always he follows in her force's wake. He sails through life and death and other life. He travels on through waking and through sleep. I think that's where we stopped last time. So I will read to the end of the canto, and then we'll look at each sentence individually. A power is on him from her occult force that ties him to his own creation's fate. And never can the mighty traveler rest, and never can the mystic voyage cease, till the nescient dusk is lifted from man's soul, and the morns of God have overtaken his night. As long as nature lasts, he too is there. For this is sure, that he and she are one. Even when he sleeps, he keeps her on his breast. Whoever leaves her, he will not depart to repose without her in the unknowable. There is a truth to know, a work to do. Her play is real, a mystery he fulfills. There is a plan in the mother's deep world-whim, a purpose in her vast and random game. This ever she meant, since the first dawn of life, this constant will she covered with her sport, to evoke a person in the impersonal void. With the truth light, strike Earth's massive roots of trance. Wake a dumb self in the inconscient depths and raise a lost power from its python sleep, that the eyes of the timeless might look out from time and the world manifest the unveiled divine. For this he left his wide infinity and laid on the spirit the burden of the flesh. That Godhead's seed might flower in mindless space. You would start, Bhuvana, 941.
And all is one thing from an occult force that lies him,
ties him
to his own creation's fate, and never can the mighty traveler rest, and never can the mystic voyage see, till the nescient dusk is lifted from man's soul, and the morns of God have overtaken his night.
So, as I mentioned earlier, this he, this him, this is the divine who dwells in the heart of all creatures, the individual divine, who identifies. He's the soul, but he identifies with nature. So he travels on the tracks that the mighty mother sets for him. And he has to follow. A power is on him from her occult force. Whether we want or not, she will drive us to our fulfillment. Well, she will drive the soul to its self-realization. And that power also ties him to the fate of his own creation, that is to say, this manifestation. The goal of many spiritual seekers has been to leave this world. There's the feeling that there's something irreparably wrong with earth life, and that the only thing for the soul to do is to seek liberation, freedom, by leaving this manifestation. Sri Aurobindo says it's such a pity that so many great souls have chosen to do that, to leave the world, when the world actually needs all these great beings to help it to its final transformation and fulfillment. And here Sri Aurobindo is saying, Justin was asking me about it the other day, that do we have a choice about that? So somewhere in his letters or his prose writings, I recall reading that he says, if that is the strong aspiration of the soul, it can leave, but then it may change its mind and decide to come back when it realizes this secret knowledge. And here it says that for the divine himself, the incarnated soul, the journey can't cease, it can't come to an end, and he can't rest, the mighty traveler cannot rest until this ignorance, this nescient darkness has been lifted from man's soul, and the morns of God, the bright dawns and mornings of the divine, have overtaken his night. If you're traveling in a plane, it happens that unexpectedly soon the dawn comes, the morning overtakes the night. So it's the same if you're traveling in a ship, although then you may not notice it so much because time passes more slowly.
Charlemagne, is it like the spring equinox?
Yes.
The morning overtakes the night.
It becomes longer than, the day becomes longer than the night, yes. But if we think about traveling westward around the world, the sun is rising behind us. No? We may start in the night, but very quickly the sun's light overtakes us. So in the course of evolution, this has to happen. So the mighty traveler cannot rest until the fulfillment comes. And then he tells us something else, Martin.
As long as nature lasts, he too is there. For this is sure, that he and she are one. Even when he sleeps, he keeps her on his breast. Whoever leaves her, he will not depart. To repose without her in the unknowable.
Yes. So perhaps the idea of those seekers who want to leave, it is to escape from the earth nature, into a higher and purer state. But he says the mighty traveler, the soul, the Lord, will not leave her. As long as nature lasts, he too will be there with her. For this is sure, that he and she are one. The mother has made a very special sketch about this image. I think it is book 1, canto 4, painting number 46 or 47. As you go out, you can see it. And she, in the agenda, she's explained the meaning of this drawing. She has made like the figure of infinity, a figure 8 of infinity. and at the top there are two little faces indicated. One is the Lord, the other is nature. And as the curves go down with nature, there's all the rainbow colors. And it goes deep down to a deep blue, the blue of unconsciousness at the bottom. And then as it goes up the other side of the eight, the blue changes and becomes golden. So they meet on the summits, and they are one in the depths.
Have you noted the colors also? Dark blue and the rainbow.
The rainbow colors are the evolution, the colors of the evolution. And the gold is the color of the supermind or the supreme state. As it comes down into the involution, into the inconscient, the blue gets darker and stronger. You have a look as you leave. So because they, he and she are one, whoever leaves her, whatever seekers may decide that they are wiser and they will leave nature, he will not depart. He won't go and rest without her in that unknowable, mysterious state beyond the manifestation. And then Sri Aurobindo explains why this is. Gumsun, would you read, please?
There is a truth to know, a walk to do, a play is real, a mystery he fulfills. There is a plan in the mother's deep world-whim, a purpose in her vast and random game.
Yes. So, what nature does may seem to be random and unpredictable. It may appear to be just whim, fancy, caprice. But in fact, there is a truth that we have to learn. Behind all this, there's a truth. And we have a work to do. All we embodied souls share in a mission. There is a work to do. And this play in the Indian tradition, we call it the Leela. That all this is a play, it's an illusion, it's a game. It is true. But it's a play, a game with a purpose. There is a purpose in her vast and random game. This is Sri Aurobindo's great teaching about this world, that it's not random and accidental. There is a purpose and there's a direction. If it were random and accidental, then everything could change tomorrow just by chance. But because there's a truth behind and a purpose behind, we can be sure that when he promises us that the transcendent will mount his throne and earth shall grow unexpectedly divine, that it's really going to happen. He, Sri Aurobindo himself, said he considers it destined and inevitable. So what was that purpose? What is that purpose behind the play of nature? You read, please, Lorraine.
There is a truth to know, a walk to do, a play is real, a mystery he fulfills. This constant will she covered with her sport to evoke a person in the impersonal void. With the truth light strike earth's massive roots of trance, wake a dumb self in inconscient depths, and raise a lost power from its python sleep. That the eyes of the timeless might look out from time, and she would manifest
the unveiled divine.
Yes. So this is what she intended from the very beginning, the first dawn of life. She's always had this will, this purpose in mind, whatever game she seemed to be playing that she covered with her sport. The idea was to evoke, to call out a person, a fulfilled individual with a capital P, in what started out as an impersonal void, a void without emptiness, without consciousness, without forms, without personality, in the very beginning of this manifestation. When this person is woken up, the truth light, the light of the superconscious, will, like lightning, will come and strike the very roots of the earth. Again, it's an image of the earth as a tree, the tree of life. No? And in that ancient image, there's a serpent, there's a worm chewing away at the roots of the tree. So it is deforming and distorting the tree. But if that truth light strikes at the roots, that worm will be finished, or he'll be transformed. A dumb self, a self unable to express itself, is deep down there in those inconscient depths at the root of matter. And what she wants to do is to raise up this lost power, that serpent, that worm that's chewing away at the roots of life, has to be wakened from its python sleep. A python is a kind of snake, a serpent, a very big, huge, powerful one that's a constrictor. It holds you tight in its coils, no? And since early times, that particular kind of snake has been the symbol of the earth power that holds onto you tight and won't let you develop. But that power, that lost power, has to be wakened up from its python sleep. Pythons are snakes who sleep for a long time. They may eat once a year or once in 2 years, and in between they just sleep. When that power is wakened, the eyes of the timeless, the one who is beyond all time, the transcendent, will be able to look out from time. Here it says, might look out from time. It doesn't mean that it's a possibility that perhaps it will happen. It means so that the eyes of the timeless can look out from time, will look out from time, when that power, lost power, is woken up. And the whole world will be able to manifest the unveiled divine. Of course, the divine is veiled in all the appearances and movements and happenings of this world, but he's veiled, we can't see him. But the intention is that eventually he shall be fully revealed in all the movements and forms of nature. Kanapan?
Void.
Yes.
Yes. Is there any etymologically any connection with avoid? You avoid something.
Well, you can think of it like that. You, if you avoid something, For you, it doesn't exist anymore.
Usually, when you put A, it means opposite.
In Sanskrit, not in English.
sexually is English.
That's
sometimes.
Right. Yeah.
It's symptomatic, is sometimes.
Yes.
And another pronunciation is right. Nescient and the inconscient or similar with the.
Yes, there's a slightly different inconscient. It suggests totally without consciousness. Nescient is more like ignorance. It's not knowing. Science is knowledge. Yes. So that negates it. So no knowledge. It's slightly different from being totally inconscient.
And here the striking, no? Is it like cutting or?
It's like lightning. She won't cut the roots of the tree. It will strike that dark power that's distorting the growth of the world tree. Ajanka, could you read the last three lines, please?
For this, he left his wife infinity, and led all the spirit, the burden of the flesh, that God had the seed made flower in mindless space.
Yes.
Oh. For this.
You want to read it again? Yes, read it one more time.
He left his wife infinity and led on the spirit the burden of the flesh, that who has seen my flowers in mindless space.
Yes. So Sri Aurobindo asks, no, if the goal was to escape, just to return to the white infinity, why would the Lord ever leave it in the first place? So here he says there was a reason why the one left his white infinity. White is the color of absolute purity, but it's also the color of integrality. There he already had everything. No? That white infinity, everything. Why would he leave it? Why would he force spirit, formless, free spirit, to wear these heavy clothes, these bodies, and all that goes with them, all the burdens that go with them? The idea was that he would scatter seeds of himself, of his divinity, many, many of them, in this mindless space, this void of the beginning of the universe, and that they should grow and grow and grow and blossom, flower beautifully. Every one of those seeds should reach their full potential. That's the great adventure of involution, of unconsciousness, and the adventure of consciousness, of returning to the great fulfillment. So if anybody asks you what Sri Aurobindo's yoga is about, what Sri Aurobindo's teaching is about, you can quote these last seven lines. To evoke a person in the impersonal void, where there was nothing, where there was asat, there has to be a living existence. To strike earth's massive roots of trance, this basis of no consciousness, the consciousness so deeply withdrawn it's not active at all. This basis for the creation. They have to be struck powerfully by the truth light, the super conscious. And that dumb self who has plunged into the depths and lost the ability to express itself, to feel, to be conscious, has to be woken up. That lost power has to be raised up from its trance, its python sleep. And when it opens its eyes, the eyes of the timeless will look out on time and space and all these wonderful beings and forms, and the whole world will manifest the divine unveiled, stripped of all disguises and coverings. This is why we have this manifestation, because the One has left His white infinity. He's laid on Himself, on spirit, this burden of being born in a body in the material universe, so that the seed of divinity might flower in where there was only unconscious, mindless space to start with. So we will see in the next canto that this knowledge that has been communicated to us in canto 4 and which King Aswapati has gained in cantos 3 and 5, well, canto 3 especially, this knowledge gives him, King Aswapati, a new insight. It awakens in him a will, a hope immense, now seized his heart. And it's that will and that hope which drives him on his journey through the whole of the rest of Canto 5, and the whole of book 2 and book 3. And we will see in book 3 that he is not able to achieve that will and hope immense. He has to pass on that great mission to his daughter, to Savitri, who incarnates as a embodiment of the Supreme Divine Mother to fulfill his aspiration. So those of you who have been here and who have gone through the whole canto, anybody has any questions to ask?
Actually, the 7 stages, I'm not able to understand how he builds up all those things.
Yeah, they are not actually not building up. It's like looking from different viewpoints. So we can go back to the beginning and look at each of the sections. We have time today. So, as I said last time, the only line in this canto which refers to King Aswapati is the first one. On a height he stood that looked towards greater heights. All the rest of the canto is about the secret knowledge, which he's beginning to see as he stands on that great height. And in the first section, what Sri Aurobindo tells us is about ourselves, that a death-bound littleness is not all we are. Might seem like that. We are human beings. We are doomed to die. We're in the grip of ignorance. We are very, very limited in our capacities of all kinds. But he says that's not the whole truth of what we are. Within us, there's a greater self living within us by ourselves unseen. And it's because of the presence of that greater self within us that human beings do exceptionally have wonderful peak experiences. It doesn't happen to everybody, but it happens to a surprising number of people. And he describes some of these special experiences that people have. And he says that's because of this greater self which is living within us. Those experiences are native, not to our human outsides, but to our greater inner self. And that greater self doesn't die when the body dies. It goes on growing and developing. And that greater self is keeping safe for us our immortal destiny, our divine destiny. That being within us knows the goal of the unconscious world, where the world is going to. And it knows the heart of the mystery of the journeying years. But all that, those experiences and that knowledge of the greater self, to us in our normal state, it's screened, veiled, it's subliminal, it's beyond the threshold of our consciousness. It's mystical, and it seems mysterious to us. To get that knowledge, we have to have an intuitive heart, or an inward turn, or the power of a spiritual gaze. Otherwise, we look out on the world here, and it looks as if it's just an accident. As if it's not going, the world is not going anywhere. So just a goalless journey, settled by chance. Or maybe there is some kind of blind will behind it. Or perhaps it just couldn't be avoided. Perhaps it's just a necessity. A necessity without aim, without purpose, and without a cause, but still it's unwillingly compelling us to exist. That basically corresponds to the materialist theory, no? That all this just had to happen because of the initial conditions that were produced by that mysterious Big Bang. And there's no purpose and no direction, no intention anywhere behind it. It's just one big accident. But still, it compels us to be the way that we are. Everything that we are and do and think and feel, it's all already determined by what things were like at the beginning. People appear on television and seriously argue like this, you know, so tell us that it's like that. And then we wonder, do we really exist? Intelligent people sometimes ask themselves this. And there was one French philosopher who said, well, I'm thinking about it, so that proves I must exist. Mother says she doesn't find this answer very satisfactory.
It's not anything. I have a doubt. So
It's Descartes who says,
yeah.
I'm wondering about it, so I must exist.
Dubito ergo sum is the doubt, not the
nothing. So he tells us in the second canto about the earth consciousness, this prevalent earth consciousness, which really doesn't know where it's going, and which lives in a kind of vacuum between some high possibility and the world of matter, and here there's some consciousness turning around and around without any clear relationship. But he says it's not like that is our greatest need, to join these three aspects again. But he also tells us that although there seem to be two ends to the creation, there's spirit and there's matter, and he describes to us the beings of spirit, and he describes to us earth nature working in matter, carrying clay images of unborn gods. He says we are not left alone in this scheme. It's not by chance that we are here. And although the beings of spirit don't seem to be in communication with us, they don't seem to be interested how we feel and so on, they are just waiting for the right moment. And meanwhile, they are guiding. And meanwhile, also, there's a divine power which is always helping us and keeping for us safe our wonderful destiny. So guided by those higher beings who can really see what is going on, the earth is being guided towards its destiny and the bliss that it's always longing for. And there's a wonderful prophecy on page 55 about how earth will grow unexpectedly divine, and maybe none of us will even notice it. God shall grow up while the wise men talk and sleep, for man shall not know the coming till its hour, and belief shall be not till the work is done. So in the third section he tells us more about the earth consciousness and these separations and how they work together. And that ends on page 60, where he tells us that nature is carrying in her a purpose which corresponds to the will on the heights. And she knows that this vast descent will come and the soul will be able to rise up. And then he starts to tell us about our relationship, our individual relationship with the divine. All here, everything here, where each thing seems its lonely self, are figures, expressions of the soul transcendent one. There is only one who is beyond everything. Everything exists because of him. Nothing could live if it were not for him. And his unseen presence is shaping these bodies of ours. And then he gives a kind of history that one has manifested himself in order to play with the mother, with his own conscious force. He's come as a playmate in the mighty mother's game, and how they are playing together and taking different roles. He moves here as the soul and she is nature, and they are playing their parts through all of us, expressing themselves through this play of the soul, making certain choices, and nature putting some limitations and compulsions on us. It is these two forces that are really determining our lives. And he says, these are the two in one. And the whole wide world is only he and she. And in the next section, he elaborates on that and this wonderful relationship between these two playmates, the Lord and the Mighty Mother, he and she. And basically, he has, incarnating into the world, he has left everything to her. He will do whatever nature tells him. He identifies with us in our ignorance. And the soul is just adoring nature and obeying her and following her and enjoying her. The spirit, this is on page 66, the spirit, the innumerable one, has left behind his lone eternity. He is an endless birth in endless time, her finite multitude in an infinite space. He has become all this, whatever the mother wants him to be. But he's still lurking in us. The master of existence lurks in us and plays at hide and seek with his own force. So we may be instruments of nature, but lurking in us is secret God. And he's doing all this for fun, for delight, for enjoyment. And he is the one who's exploring and enjoying this whole universe. And so the poet images him as an adventurer and cosmologist. Now I'm on page 69, of a magic earth's obscure geography. He's the explorer and the mariner on a secret inner ocean without bourne. And there's without bourne, it means without limit. There's no limit to all this, and there's no last certitude in which thought can pause, and no terminus. There's no end to the soul's experience. And then we come to the last section, which describes the voyage, the journey, how the traveler learns his craft, develops and grows, and eventually comes to, he reaches the world's end and looks beyond a greater world. Time's traveler must explore, and he feels the call of that greater world, and he recognizes that all the time in this earthly embodiment, in this ship of his, he's been he realizes that his is a search of darkness for the light, a search of mortal life for immortality. That's what we are all really moving towards. Perfect consciousness, deathless life. But meanwhile, until we realize all that, the mother is driving us across the ocean, and we can't stop. That's what we read today. She won't let us stop until she's fulfilled her purpose, the purpose in her vast and random game. Does that help you,
yes. Bhuvana? Yeah, I have to go and read, I have to go section by section.
Yes, but you can see there is a theme for each of the sections. And how wonderfully and subtly he reveals this relationship between nature, the play of what seems to us unconscious prakriti, and the conscious being, and the conscious being taking these three poises as the transcendent, as the cosmic spirit, and as the individual soul.
A power is on him from her occult force that ties him to his own creation's fate. And never can the mighty traveler rest, and never can the mystic voyage cease, till the nescient dusk is lifted from man's soul, and the morns of God have overtaken his night. As long as nature lasts, he too is there, for this is sure, that he and she are one. Even when he sleeps, he keeps her on his breast. Whoever leaves her, he will not depart to repose without her in the unknowable. There is a truth to know, a work to do. Her play is real, a mystery he fulfills. There is a plan in the mother's deep world-whim, a purpose in her vast and random game. This ever she meant since the first dawn of life. This constant will she covered with her sport. To evoke a person in the impersonal void. With the truth light strike earth's massive roots of trance, wake a dumb self in the inconscient depths, and raise a lost power from its python sleep. That the eyes of the timeless might look out from time, and the world manifest the unveiled divine. For this he left his white infinity, and laid on the spirit the burden of the flesh. That Godhead's seed might flower in mindless space.